Good morning, everyone. We welcome you to the lecture series of AICT Atal's sponsored 5-day faculty development program on photonics for green energy demand, organized by Thakur College of Engineering and Technology from 23rd to 27th November 2020.
EC1D, application file with this icon. So please double click on that and you will be able to see this kind of a window. So once you have done that, please put a message in the chat box so that I can understand that you all have been able to do that. Okay. So a few more, because there are 56 participants. So a few more, like around 10-15 people, if you have already done, then okay. Okay. And if someone is unable to do, please tell that also, so that I will wait for some more time. Okay. So let me go to the first slide. So as I had already told you in my last session, this PC1D software is basically a free software, and we should be really thankful to the scientists who have developed this and made it available for free. And they are scientists from URSW who have developed this and helped us to learn so much. It should be our motive, like we should share more and more whatever we know, because that should be the aim of our life. And we should be really thankful to the scientists who have done this software and made it available for free. So I am using, or I have also distributed, the version 5.9, which I'll be using in this workshop. But there are more much advanced versions also. I saw that is available, so you can later on you can use that also. What is the difference is that they have added some new models, and you will be able to see the parameters, the output parameters, more output parameters in those, in the updated ones. So but it won't be a problem if we are using this version, at least to learn. Now in the when I was discussing in the last session, I was discussing about the device area, the reflectance, the thickness of the substrate, the doping concentrations, and everything that should be included. So we will be varying all these parameters, and we will see how it affects the efficiency of the solar cell. And in this, we can actually see the curves. I was talking about the generation rate, how it is varying with the thickness of the thickness of the device. So here we can see that we can actually generate a curve where the generation rate is varying with the thickness of the device. So the carrier densities, you can see the band diagram, you can see, of course, IV also you can see. So you can generate all these curves and then compare for different parameters. So this is an advantage that we are going to get by using this software. And most important, it is very good for beginners to understand what is going on in a solar cell. So that is something very good. So you must be getting this kind of a graphical user interface. So what we will do, how we will do this simulation part is, we will define a structure. We will observe all the curves that we are generating. We will modify the parameters. And then again, we will observe the different parameters. So this is how we will be doing it. So let's start with defining the cell. Okay, I will just check with the, okay, if anyone is having any kind of problem in following what I am saying, or you are missing out on the steps, please let me know. Okay. So we have to first give a device area. So people fabricate smaller devices also. Some people fabricate larger devices also. So it depends on the fabrication capabilities. But what we do in our place, in our lab, is we are fabricating 156 mm into 156 mm wafers. We are processing that kind of wafers. So it is around 6-inch cross 6-inch wafers. So if you see the device area is around 244.3 centimeter square. So I will just use that device area. But if you want to simulate a smaller one, you can simulate some smaller one. It should give the same result, because we actually normalize the result with the area. So if you double click on device area, you can put 244.3. And since we are using centimeter square, this is selected. If you are using others, then you can actually select the others. But for this session, what I am showing you, it will be centimeter square only. So that I have selected. So device area I have selected as 244.3 because that is what we are fabricating here. Others can use the smaller ones.
If possible, can we increase the window size? It's quite difficult to view for few of the viewers.
Okay, window size of the presentation or the PC one?
PC one D.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. So in a surface texturing, basically you can texture the front surface and rear surface also. So we do that in our lab. So in this particular case, I am not selecting anything because we will just do a simple one. For first simulation will be a very simple one. We won't include any texture or anything. And in surface charge also, someone was asking about the surface charge in the last session, like how to reduce recombination. So my answer was that you can put surface charges and you can improve the recombination. But here we will not put any surface charge, again for simplicity. If you want, you can put and you can also check. But for this session, I'm not putting any surface charge. Reflectance. Here, if you double click, for the time being, for this first simulation, I am putting reflectance as zero. So what does this mean? It means that all the light that is incident on the solar cell is getting into the solar cell, into the device. Nothing is reflected back. That is not the ideal case, but just we want to see if it is 0%, what will be the result. And later on, we will also change the reflectance and we will see what is the effect on that. So we will use fixed and we'll put it zero itself, nothing else. Okay. So we will not work with contacts also now. If we don't select anything, it means that ideal or ohmic contacts have been assumed. So we won't do anything with it right now. Later on, we'll keep adding each of them. So right now, we are not using anything. Now, you will see as I am changing the details in region, you will find changes in this schematic also. Since I have not selected any surface texturing, we don't see any texture over here. But if you would have selected surface texturing, see, there is change in that surface texture. Okay. But I won't select it for the time being. So thickness has been given as 10 micrometer. If you want, you can do, but for our time being, for this simulation, what we do practically is we use 180 micrometer. So here we will put 180, so it will be 180 micrometer. material by default it is taken as silicon. But still, we will again select it, double click on it, and we will select silicon. So silicon has been taken as a material, and all the properties related to silicon, like the carrier mobilities, the dielectric constant, band gap, intrinsic concentration at 300 Kelvin, all these has been taken for silicon. Refractive index, absorption coefficient, everything has been taken for silicon. Now we need a p-type background doping. So p-type substrate, here in the question we have given it as 10 to the power 17 centimeter cube. So we'll double click and put it as 17, and we select p-type. It should be selected as p-type only, and then okay. So later on, when we are finished with the simulation, when you are doing it on your own, you can actually change the background doping and compare it, basically. That if you are taking it 10 to the power 16, what is the result? 10 to the power 17, 10 to the power 20, what difference you get, and at what point you are getting the maximum efficiency. So these kind of things you can actually practice. So this is the substrate. The substrate is p-type, and it is 10 to the power 17. Per centimeter cube. Now we will go for a front diffusion. Because we need a p-n junction, at the top we need a n-type diffusion. So front junction, you can select, enable. Once you enable, you can actually select between n-type or p-type. We want it as n-type, so n-type is selected. And peak doping is 10 to the power 20. Depth, we want, as in the question, it is given as 400 nanometer. Here it is given 400 nanometer. We'll put here 0.4 because it is, the unit is in micrometer. So 400 nanometer is equal to 0.4 micrometer. Peak position is at 0 degree. That is okay, because at the surface it will be having the peak, and we want it to be uniform profile. Uniform is not ideally uniform, we don't get it uniform, we usually get a slope. That also will show you, we'll see and compare basically. And then we'll click it, okay. So you can see that emitter has been n-type emitter, a red line has been formed over here. Since the device is 180 micrometer, and on top of that we have a very thin n-type emitter, that is just a small line over here. If you would have increased the thickness of n-type emitter, you could see how a thicker emitter over here, but for the timing it is like this only.
Ma'am, can you please repeat the previous step?
Okay, so previous step, that is the diffusion part.
The p-type doping.
Okay, from the p-type doping. So p-type doping is the basically the substrate that we have taken. Okay, so even in fabrication also, what we get is a p-type wafer. So the p-type wafer is 180 micrometer thick, and we are doping it. It is usually doped beforehand. So what is the doping we have taken here? It is 1 into 10 to the power 17. 1 is 17. Okay, this is the doping concentration. So it's the substrate. Now on top of this p-type doping, we will do a n-type emitter. We need a p-n junction for the solar cell, so we should have a n-type emitter. So for that n-type emitter, what we did here in the front diffusion, we will click, double click on it. You select on enable. Once you do enable, you will get two options, n-type, p-type. We want it n-type, so select n-type. And we want the peak doping to be 1E20. Again, later on you can change and see also. So this will be 1E20. Depth factor is 0.4 micrometer, because in the question we have here it is as 400 nanometer. 400 nanometer is equal to 0.4 micrometer. So it will be 0.4 micrometer. And we have chosen the uniform profile. Uniform profile, it means that for the entire emitter, the doping will be 1 into 10 to the power 20. That is what we have chosen here. If we choose exponential or the Gaussian or the error function, the doping will vary with that function through the thickness of the emitter. We will see. We will do another example where we will choose a practical doping concentration we will use.
Ma'am, one more thing. After this, yeah. Can you repeat the material selection also?
Yeah, I'll show that.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
So, material selection, we are working with silicon right now. Okay. So, first in this region, what we have done, we have taken the thickness, and just below the thickness, you have material. Okay, this material thing. So, if you double click on the material, we'll find a number of materials here: aluminium, gallium arsenide, amorphous silicon, gallium arsenide, germanium. So we will select silicon over here and then open. So silicon has been chosen as the material. So in this case, what happened? The entire structure becomes a silicon. Okay, the entire structure. If we are choosing amorphous, then the entire structure will be amorphous. That is a kind of limitation. I don't know if they have sorted it out in the newer versions, but in this case, that is one thing, that the entire one will be crystalline silicon. It is not amorphous silicon. If you select amorphous, it will be entirely amorphous. If you select crystalline silicon, it will be entirely crystalline silicon, that way. So once we have selected the material, all the properties here will be of silicon only. All the properties have been selected as silicon. Now, once we have chosen the material, we have selected the background doping. The P-type substrate is the background doping. Then we have formed.
Ma'am, can I interrupt?
Yeah, sure.
Some of them could not select the silicon material.
Okay, so sometimes what it happens, you know, that you select it, just go back and then again select PC1D5. Then I think you did not get the option. Sometimes it is a bug actually.
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am, but it's getting selected, but it's giving an error saying that error loading silicon 003 file. And also it's again saying that error reading the refractive index for silicon 003 file. It's getting selected.
Okay. So what I will suggest is, can you just close it and open it again?
Sure, ma'am.
And if the problem persists, then just let it be, okay? Just don't select anything, because it will by itself it will take silicon only, so no need to select at all. So sometimes it happens because, you know, it is a free software. They are trying to improve it on their own. There is not only two or three people maybe involved in it, so sometimes there are bugs. If you report it to them, they will solve it. It happens sometimes. So if in case you are not able to select the material, then just let it be. Don't do anything, just let it be, because by default it will be silicon only. So have you restarted it?
Yes, ma'am, I restarted it and it's working. Even if it's showing the error, it's actually quite well working. So I think it's a bug. Okay. Still we can
okay. So have people already taken the background doping and the front diffusion also? If you have taken, then I will go forward, otherwise I will wait till you can complete that step. There is a question, I think, how small device area we can choose. So 1 centimeter square that they have given here, I have not worked less than that. So you can just try and see, there is no harm. It is only a software. It won't get angry or do anything. It's fine if you can choose less than that. I think they have given micrometer square also. So I think you can choose micrometer square also. Some few micrometers also. So you can just check and see. So should I go forward? Just let me know if I can move forward.
Ma'am, there is a question. It is saying why 244.3 centimeter square?
Okay, so we are taking 6 inch cross 6 inch cells in our lab. Okay, so 6 inch, the exact measurement is 156.75 mm into 156.75 mm. So if you take that area, you will get around 244.3. That is the exact area that we get for our solar cells. So that is why we are selecting 244.3, because that is the, for an industrial solar cell, crystalline silicon solar cell, that is the area for the time being. They are talking about increasing the size of the wafers, but for the time being, this is the area that we are working with.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question here. What if we want to choose a different material which is not available in the list?
I'm not very sure because I have not chosen any other material, but I think give me some time, because I think we can work it out. If we have the material properties, we can, I think, generate a .mat file and we can do that if someone needs it. So you can just mail me. I will try to find out we can include if we have a .mat file and we have the properties. So if what material you want to use, you can just mail me. I will try to include it if I can.
Sure ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
So any other questions till now?
As of now, no questions, ma'am. We can proceed, I guess.
Ma'am, yeah. I have one question.
Yeah.
Whenever I have chosen the material from the list, it is showing that automatically dielectric constant and band gap, those are changing according to the material. But
yes.
my observation is that the intrinsic concentration at 300 Kelvin, that concentration is not changing at all right now. It's my just observation for silicon and gallium arsenide. At 300 Kelvin, it should be changed from material to material.
Yeah, it should change from material to material, right. So it will be different if you're taking germanium, it will be different if you're taking any other material. So I will suggest that you please keep a note of the things that you are observing which are not changing, so that you can make a list. And what usually happens is if you come across a bug or something like this, you can send a mail to these people, you know, the scientists. They, when you if you go to the website, you will find that those things. So they will be very happy actually if you can tell them about these bugs. Or maybe if you are using the newer version, maybe in that this problem may not be there. So it is good that you are actually observing that. Since I have been using silicon and I'm used to this, so I haven't noticed that. It is good that you notice that. So keep a track of what you are observing. And you can actually send a mail if you are observing these kind of bugs, actually.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So we have got a PN junction till now. So the next thing that we will do is we have to select a bulk recombination. So what happens is when we get a wafer with us, it has a lifetime. That particular wafer is having a lifetime. Depending on how that wafer has been manufactured, or how that wafer has been, what kind of wafer has been supplied to us by the manufacturer, the efficiency of the solar cell will change. So it can vary from 50 microseconds to thousands of microseconds to milliseconds also. So normally what we get are usually 100 microseconds, but later on, we may also use higher lifetime wafers also. So here, when you choose bulk recombination, we have to give that value. So what we are using right now is 100. So please put tau n and tau p as 100 microseconds. Double click on bulk repletion and select and put the value 100 in that. So better is the lifetime. The more is the lifetime of the wafer, the carriers will be able to move to a longer length and the recombination will be low. So we always look for better lifetime wafers. The better is the lifetime of the wafer, the better will be the efficiency of the solar cell. But then getting these kind of wafers become difficult. It is not easily available and they also become costly also. So we have to see that part also. So for the time being, we will use bulk recombination as 100 microsecond. And front surface recombination at the surface, front surface will choose 1 cm/s. That is really, really low, very low, which means that at surface is very well passivated. There are no dangling bonds. No dangling bonds, there means that no recombination is taking place at the surfaces. So we are taking truly a very ideal case. Okay. So this is SN has been taken as 1 cm/s. At rear recombination also, we take 1 cm/s. So please let me know if everyone has completed up to this part, because this is how we have defined the structure of the solar cell. All the parameters we have given. After this, we will give the excitation on the device. So. Okay, so most of them are saying that they have done. Okay, now we'll go to excitation. So what is this excitation? We have to we want to generate an IV curve. So if we want to generate an IV curve, what we have to do, we have to change the bias across the cell. So the bias across the cell needs to be varied from 0 to say 1 volt or that, or we can also, if we want to see the negative part also, we can bias from -1 to +1, okay, and see that kind of what kind of I current that is passing through the device. So we have to give that bias. That is what excitation is doing. In excitation, we will bias the solar cell from one particular voltage to another particular voltage. So that can vary from minus to plus some value. So we, for a particular, for crystalline solar cells, we usually give from -1 to +1. So if we want to give the excitation, we have to choose excitation mode. If you click on the excitation mode, you will get three options: equilibrium, steady state, and transient. We will choose transient because our bias will vary with time. Because with time the bias will vary, so we will choose transient. So number of steps we will choose as say 100, and time step size you can choose as 0.01. So again, this part is very important. I want everyone to actually confirm if they have done this part. So everyone has to select transient because we are varying the bias with time, and give the number of steps. Number of steps is 100. Time step size is 0.01. And then you have to click OK. So the excitation mode is transient and with 100 time steps. Okay. Now, if we will put a light on them so that we can have the illuminated characteristic. If we don't want illuminated characteristic, if we want dark, we won't apply any light. So we want to apply, if we want to see the IV characteristic under illumination, what we need to do, we have to apply one sun, similar to one sun. We have to simulate the device under one sun. So what we will do for that, on the menu bar, if you go, you will see excitation, this excitation step, excitation option. Just click on that excitation option and then you will be able to see open. The second last option is open. If you click on open, you will see one sun. Again, for some people you may or may not see, then just go back to one folder again, you can come back and also select. If you select one sun, you will see the primary light source has been enabled, constant constant intensity 0.1 watt per centimeter square, which is 1000. What was LG? And the base circuit will sweep from minus 0.8 to 0.8. That is quite fine. Minus 1 to 0.1, minus 0.8 to 0.8 is also fine. If you want to change, you can select and change also, but it is fine. So these two steps are very important. So excitation, first we have to select transient. From transient, we have given it, okay, how, why it is 16 steps? I gave 100 steps now. 100 steps. Okay. So we have selected one sun and then transient 100, transient mode in 100 time steps. The sweep is from minus 0.8 to plus 0.8. So, and the intensity is 1000 watt per centimeter square. Okay, there is no secondary light source. This is the only light source that we have. So, please let me know if you have completed till this part. Yeah, please set the transient parameters to 100 once again. Okay, so we have now designed the structure of the solar cell. We have given all the parameters of the solar cell and we have also given the excitation also. That is, now the solar cell, if we run the simulation, the solar cell will give us the result under one sun. Okay, so how to run the solar cell? You can go to compute on top and click run, or you can see a person running here. There is one option here, person is running. So you can click on that also. So once you click on run, it will immediately give you the results. So, have you got the results? So, is anyone else getting a transient convergence failure? So, just check if you have done the steps as. So the results you will find, just below the results you will find the short circuit current, maximum base power output, open circuit, this kind. For people who are getting a transient failure, kindly see if you have given the time step as 0.01 and time step at 0, t equal to 0 as 1e minus 9. This is a very small window. I don't know if it is visible, but just check. Transient will be number of time steps will be 100. Time step size is 0.01. And time step at t equal to 0 is 1e minus 9.
Ma'am, I have one question.
Yeah. Tell me.
Ma'am, all the parameters that you have suggested, I have given all the parameters according to your device. But the result is showing different, totally different from your result.
Okay, what is the result?
Yeah, short circuit IB is showing 3.888 ampere. Maximum base power cut is 3.661 E minus 4 watts. And open circuit VB is minus 3.766 E to the power minus 4 volts.
Okay, so I think there has been some problem. Is the device area 244.3 centimeter square?
Yes, ma'am. Nothing. Okay. I have changed.
Okay. So, one thing that you can do is, I don't know if it is visible for everyone. So, where there are small images that has been given on the menu bar, you will see a colorful graph-like structure they are showing. It is giving us four graphs view. Please click on that. Please click on that.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this is the first one is giving the energy band, okay? The energy band diagram for the complete device. So, and the second one is generation and recombination values they have given, and it is varying with the device. This fourth one is the base current and power. So, are you getting it in this way? Is the IV curve in this
Yes,
way?
Ma'am. Oh. All these things are same, but the graph.
Yeah, I think there has been some change. Maybe
the energy bands and distance from front. These two are that carrier densities. These two are same, but the second and fourth one are totally different.
I think then there has been a mistake in the simulation. I think I will suggest you either you completely close it and then do it again, because it happens sometimes. So, and then you can just check and see. I will also give you the manual also, and actually in this presentation also I will share this presentation also. In the presentation I have also given screenshot of all the process steps. So when you do it yourself also, you will be able to do it. And still, if you are not able to do, you can just give me a call. We can set up a meeting and I will show you, okay? Because there are so many people involved, you know, that maybe I have gone faster or something, that you may have missed a step or something like that. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. But my last question is that, is there any option to check whether my results are showing exactly same with others or not? How we can check the feasibility as well as whether it is what we can say it is correct
right or not. Yeah. So the first thing is that the more you practice, you will be able to understand what is right and what is wrong. Because now, for example, if I could see your IV curve, I could actually tell you that the mistake has happened. Okay, IV curve should be like this. Okay, it is in the fourth quadrant, so the IV curve is fine, and this is the power curve. If you are not getting an IV curve in this way, it means that it is wrong. Okay. Secondly, say if someone is having this one is straight and it has gone this way. Okay, first it is straight, then it has gone in this way. Then there is something wrong with the shunt resistance value. This kind, actually, the more you work with the parameters, you will have an experience and you will be able to understand from the IV curve itself that where you have gone wrong. So since I have been using the, I have been working with solar cell for a long time, I can see a IV curve and tell where it has gone wrong. Okay. So that needs practice. So there is nothing to worry about. The more you do, you will be able to understand. I will also suggest that if two or three people are doing it together, when you sit together or you start doing the simulations together, you will find that you can be able to compare your results. Or you can do it yourself also. You can change the parameters one by one and you will compare the results. So in the second session also, I will actually show you how we will change and compare the results. Okay.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Excuse me, ma'am. I closed it and opened it again. And when I selected for excitation one sun, it is showing error reading spectrum file, AM15G.SPC. And this is the same error which I got last time. But when I press OK, it gives me the same parameters as shown on your screen. And it even changes the transient numbers which you suggested to change. So is it this problem which is not allowing it to give me the...
Maybe it can be a problem, because what happens, and this also I have seen, that it doesn't work on some computers. That also happens sometimes. That is okay. Also a problem. So you can just do this on a separate computer.
Okay. Okay. I'll try that.
File into another computer and you can also check. Okay.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
So I have, even I have, I think I have changed some values or something. So, okay, these are the four graphs you can see. And if you right click on each graph, click on one graph, then you will select that graph. Say this IV curve, click on the IV curve. And then if you right click, okay, it's not working. So, okay, you can go to graph and go to temporal and base IV. So you will get only the IV curve over here. Graph, you go to graph, then temporal, and then base IV. You will get the IV curve. And then you can go to graph again and copy graph data. So you can copy this graph and graph data basically, and you can copy it in Excel or Origin or wherever you want to do the analysis. So as you will be changing the parameter, you keep copying the graph data and pasting it in that, so that you can compare the different curves. Okay, what will happen here is you are simulating one device and that device is giving you one result. Now you will change the parameter, these results will change, but you need to remember what you got earlier so that you can compare. So you can copy this graph data and you can put it in Excel file or Origin file. And then keep pasting that, okay, so that you can compare it later on. So if you want the graph data, you go to graph and then copy graph. Is that okay? So should I repeat the steps after selection of excitation mode? Okay. So if you want to go back to the device structure, so you just beside the graph, there is this parameter view. If you click on parameter view, you will go back to the structure, so what we were designing actually. So I have done a full screen over here. So excitation, you go to excitation and then open and one sun and select open. Then this one sun is selected. If you want more time steps, you can, 16 time steps is also okay. The more time steps you will take, it will be a better graph actually. The smaller time steps you take, you will see it yourself also. The smaller time steps you will take, the graph will not be smooth. It will be very rough kind of a graph. So I always prefer the maximum large number of time steps listed. So you can just click on the number of time steps. You can put it as 100 or 50. Time step size, you can put it as 0.01. And then, okay. Then just check the sweep. Sweep is from point minus 0.8 to 0.8. This is fine, or you can also take 0 to 0.8 also. Why we are taking 0.8 is, if you see the graph over here, at around, this is the VOC, this is 0.65, around 0.65, this is the VOC. At VOC, it is crossing the voltage bar. This is crossing the zero actually. I equal to zero. It is crossing at I equal to zero. So we need to see this. So it should always, the voltage bias should be always greater than the VOC, so that you can get this point. If you don't get this point, you will not be able to find out what is the VOC. So you can take 0.7. Usually in crystalline silicon solar cell, it is around 0.65. Around that range, you can take up to 0.7 also. 0.7 and 0.8 is fine. So here is someone has asked me a question. Okay, so how to go back to the device from the graph? So where we have found a graph, just beside that, there is a parameter view. If you click on that parameter view, you can go back to that. Okay, someone has asked me a question like get the efficiency of the solar cell. So in the advanced versions, you will already get what is the efficiency they are giving it. But here I would like you to calculate actually. If you have minus 9.003 ampere, 4.95 watt, and open circuit voltage, then what will be the fill factor and efficiency? I think this can be a problem. You can actually find out and tell me. That is a question from my side. Calculate and tell me what will be the answer. What will be the fill factor? Because we have the power output, we have the short circuit current, we have the open circuit current. You can go back to the equation and you can just tell me. So I'll just repeat the equation. The equation for fill factor is, if you get the maximum power is, if you have the PM divided by short circuit current and short circuit current into VOC, IC into VOC, that will give us the fill factor. So PM divided by IC into VOC gives us the fill factor. So what is the fill factor that you might be getting for this? Can someone please tell me? Actually, if you do the here, I can see Dr. Bhavna. I think I don't know what exact values you have got, but 85.16% efficiency is very high. I think you're talking about fill factor. Yes. Yeah, fill factor is around 0.84 or 83.9 actually, basically. That answer is 83.9. And efficiency, how we will calculate? Efficiency, we will calculate, we have the power output PM divided by 1000 watt per meter square. So we can just take the power output because PM divided by the input power, what is that, is 1000 watt per meter square. So we have to find that and then divide it by area. So please find out what is the power output, 4.95 watts. Now if we want power output per unit area, what we have to do, we have to divide it by area. So 4.95 divided by 244.3. So that will be power output at in watt per centimeter square, because we have the area in centimeter square. And then we have to divide it by the input. Input is 0.1 watt per centimeter square. So in that way, you can find out. Please tell me how much is the efficiency then. P input is given as, you see, P input is the constant intensity at 0.1 watt per centimeter square. Please check if you are dividing it with the area device, area that you have taken, because the efficiency shall be slightly higher than that. Please check if you have taken the device area correct, because the efficiency should be slightly higher than 18%. So this is what actually we need to do. We need to find out the short circuit current, we need to find out open circuit voltage, we need to find out the power output, and we should be able to calculate the fill factor and efficiency. And the more we practice, the more we do these simulations, at one point of time you will be able to say whether your fill factor is right, whether your efficiency is right. So in this case, the efficiency is 20.2. right, the efficiency is 20.2. Yes, it is absolutely achievable. It can be achieved here itself. For our the baseline solar cells, we are getting at 19.5, and mind it that we have taken reflection as zero, front reflection as zero. That is right. The reflection will be slightly higher than that. So the efficiency should, we can achieve around 20% for aluminium BSF cell, the kind of structure that we are studying, 20% is fine, we can get that. But of course, you must be aware that we have taken some assumptions over here, like we have taken ideal contacts, we have taken reflection is equal to zero. So we will change that, we will change them one by one. So the calculation is, for fill factor will be maximum power output divided by ISC into VOC. Okay, and for efficiency, it will be maximum power output per unit area divided by input power. So the input power in this case is 0.1 watt per centimeter square. So what you have to do, you have to divide this power output by the revised area, then you will get power output per unit area divided by the input intensity, that is 0.1 watt per centimeter square, that is given here. You have to be very careful with the units you are using. If the device area is in centimeter, then this intensity should also be in centimeter square. If the device area is in meter square, then you have to check that this should be in meter square, like that. So you have to be careful in that, with that. So yesterday I had got slightly different results. Maybe I had used something. So this is what I got. So today the power max is slightly higher. So I have got some different results today. Okay. So this is all about the IV curve. We have got the IV curve. Now, if you would like to see the quantum efficiency also, you would like to see the spectral response of the solar cell. So in that case, what you need to do, in this excitation modified from one sun dot excitation file, here you double click it, and just below one sun, you will also find scan QE. So you have to select scan QE and then open it. So the place where you had selected one sun, so excitation, you can double click the excitation, you will find scan QE. Just select that and nothing else. And you can see the wavelength range has been selected from 300 to 1200 nanometer. There are many people who are doing from 300 to 1100 nanometer only. So you can select that also. So you can do it according to your application, what range you want to study. So P, how to find P in PC1D? So P in is already given here, you see. P in is already given here, the constant intensity. Constant intensity is already given here. There are many other methods also. Usually it is considered as 1000 watt per meter square or 0.1 watt per centimeter square. There is also a way of why it has come, but I will have to again describe many other things to show that. Basically, it is integrated from the entire spectral response, spectral irradiance of the solar cell. All the photons at each wavelength, they are integrated. If we are integrated, we can find it that the constant intensity comes to at from 940 to 900, this kind of value. So we consider it as 1000 watt per meter square or 0.1 watt per centimeter square. Again, there is also, this is the standard value that we take. This value can change from one region to another region. So in Bombay, it may be at this point of time, it will vary from day to day. From morning, the intensity will be different. At evening, the intensity will be different. At 12 o'clock, the intensity will be different. The kind of intensity that we get in Bombay will be different from that of Calcutta. This kind of things we need to take care of. But the standard, for standard calculations, we take it as 1000 watt per centimeter per meter square. Okay, what is scan QE? We will take it as scan QE, and then please run the structure once again, just the way you have run. Click it as run, and then just click on the interactive graph view. You will find a quantum efficiency graph. You can see the quantum efficiency graph over here. So you have generated the quantum efficiency graph from this PC1D software. Again, you can go to graph and you can copy the graph data and keep it for future comparison. Since we have selected no reflection from the sun surface, so reflection from the sun surface is zero, we are not able to see the reflection here, over here. There is a reflection graph which is lying down here, which we cannot see. It is completely zero. Next, in the next session, we will be adding reflection graphs also. So in that case, we will see the changes, how the things change. So constant intensity is 0.1 watt per centimeter square or 1000 watt per meter square. So you have to be very careful of what is the unit. So parameter window, this is the parameter window. After doing the scan QV, after I have done the scan QV, this is the parameter window. If you want, you can take a screenshot of this. So basically, in the next session, what we will do, we will use the same model, but we will keep on changing one parameter after the another. So you can just take a screenshot of this, and in the break time or if you have time, you can, I am telling this for people who have not got the results, you can try it once again, because in the next session you will need it. In the next session also, we'll have to generate, we will need this model so that we can move further. Yeah, this actually, it is giving some garbage value. This short circuit current value is not at all important. 6.9 × 10⁻²⁷ amps, it is giving a garbage value for scan QE. Okay, so how to bring the wavelength range? So double click on this monochrome wavelength from 300 to 200, 1200, and here you can change the wavelength range. There is one more important thing that I would like to actually inform you, that this is the quantum efficiency that you can see, right? So if you integrate this entire the area and find out the area under the curve, you can do it numerically by numerical analysis. You can use some software also to do it. Then the short circuit, after integration, the value you will get will be equal to the short circuit current density. So you are getting 9 amperes right now. So 9 divided by area, it will be short circuit current density. Current divided by area will be short circuit current density. So when you integrate the entire range, you will get that value. Why? Because it is this area under the curve that is giving the current. So if there are, say, at 300 nanometer, what has happened? Say there are 100 photons. Out of 100 photons, only 70 have given an electron hole pair. Remaining 30, we have lost these 30 photons. So the number of electron hole pairs that we have got for each wavelength, that will be added up, and that will give us the current. Okay. That is the meaning of quantum efficiency. So we will have to work continuously so that we can stop losing, we can avoid losing the photons over these areas. That is our main purpose. So PC1D values are actually publishable. You have to refer, you have to cite that you have done this in PC1D. If you go to their website, actually, you will find out that there are a number of papers that they have published. And basically, what you can publish and not publish depends on the novelty of your work. So if you have already a structure in mind, or you are comparing something, some parameters, and you are telling something, a new story, then you can definitely publish this work. But you have to just cite that you have done this in PC1D. Yes, so our area is given in centimeter square. So P input should be in watt per centimeter square only. So our input, if you can see, the constant intensity is at 0.1 watt per centimeter square. So that is our P input. And if you take P in as watt per meter square, it will be 1000. In that case, you have to take the area also in 1000. In centimeter, in meter square. So I think this is what I wanted to show in the first session. In the next session, what I will be doing, I will change one parameter after the other, and we will see what changes each parameter change will bring, how the efficiency will vary because of the changes in the parameters. So you can ask me if there are any more questions. Is it possible to dope with another material in p-type? What kind of doping are you asking? In p-type doping, we use, I mean, we don't use, we get it p-type doped only. It is usually boron doped. That is what we get. But yeah, we can dope it with any group 3 material. But what we get usually from our manufacturers is boron doped.
Yes, any other questions from participant side? Either you can unmute and ask the questions or you can type it in chat box.
Actually, Dr. Bhavna has asked here, 0.1 watt per centimeter square is equal to 1000 watt per meter square. So it will be 0.1 watt per centimeter square is equal to 1000 watt per meter square. No, we cannot simulate photodetectors in this software. This is specifically for solar cells. We cannot do that.
Madam, hello.
हेलो
हाँ मैडम, हेयर ये कांस्टेंट वैल्यू इज 1 × 10⁻³. सो हाउ वी पुट 0.1 वाट पर सेंटीमीटर स्क्वायर? मैडम इट शुड बी 0.001.
So I think when we have selected QE, at that time it is into a minus water square. If I take it as one sun, I think it will be 0.1. Yeah, when you are taking one sun, it is 0.1.
Madam, so can we change this from the source intensity in steady state or transient state? So here the value is given as 0.01, madam. 0.001, madam. So instead of using 0.1, that should be taken 0.001, madam. If I double click on that, so the value shown that should be 0.001, madam. So how we take 0.1, madam?
Is it so?
As we take the area in centimeter square, so power should be taken in watt per centimeter square, and the value should be 0.001 instead of getting 0.1, madam. So our efficiency will change accordingly.
Just let me check. So we have 4.92, our base power output is 4.928. Okay, so 4.928. Okay, and this is watts. Now we'll divide it by the area. So it will be 244.3. Okay, so it is giving as 0.0201. Okay, so it is giving as okay, I understand your question. 4.928 divided by 244.3. So divided by 0.1 give 0.20. Okay. So what is happening is, why this confusion is, We are finding the efficiency in percentage. So we will do P output by P input into 100. So what you are getting by just getting the ratio Can you hear me? So we are doing p output by p input into 100. Then you will get the right answer. So constant intensity point in what is correct? So p output divided by p into 100. That will give us in percentage because we are talking efficiency in terms of percentage. Then you will get your correct answer. I am not able to actually understand why this transient conversion failure is occurring. I will again suggest that please close it and do it once again so that you will be able to. Actually, I can't understand why it is coming transient conversion failure. Have you selected the number as 100 steps and time as 0.01? And the last one was something like this. What was the last thing? Time step at t is equal to 0 as 1e minus 9.
Madam, in case of getting quantum efficiency, we are using constant intensity.
I could not hear you the last part. I could not hear the last part. Can you please repeat? Hello?
Maybe he is facing some network issues, ma'am.
Okay. So Kriti ma'am, what I will suggest is, can you just close it and then do it again? Because I don't know why this transient convergence failure is occurring. Or I can do one thing. I can actually save this model and then mail you. Then you can just use that also.
Okay.
I will just save this one. I will save this as a project. Example.
Hello, madam.
Yeah, and I'll mail this. Yeah.
Hi, madam. For getting quantum efficiency graph, we are using constant intensity of an amount of 1 into 10 to the power minus 3. But in case of one sun, we are using 0.1. So for getting quantum efficiency curve, our solar cell efficiency will change?
No. I think when they are using this CanQ, right? When they are using this scan QE, the constant intensity is 10 to the power minus 3 watt per centimeter square. I have to check why they are giving it as 10 to the power minus 3 watt per centimeter square. So I am not sure because this is not the right value.
So that should be 0.1.
Yes, 0.1.
That means 1 into 10 to the power minus 1 instead of minus 3, that should be minus 1.
Yes.
To get the same efficiency.
Yes.
So that's I am asking, madam. Thank you.
So, any more question?
Yes. Any more questions from participant side?
So I will. What this model? I will just mail Sukruti ma'am. So I think you should be able to use this when we do the next part. So people who have not been able to get it can actually use this project also.
Okay, ma'am. Sure. Able to use this. I will mail all the participants.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. One question is there in chat box now, how to see quantum efficiency graph?
Okay. So let me run this. Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So again, if you go to this four graphs view, there also you can see. There is, you can see the quantum efficiency graph over here. And next to that also, you can see here also. Four graphs view also you can check, or interactive graph view.
Madam, how to save the, madam, how to save the file? Madam, how to save the file with which extension?
It will be pr.prm.
Madam, how to save the
save in PRM. The file. Oh. Okay, right, then save as. You give the name and it will be saved as .prm.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
And when you open this file, just go to file, open that .prm file, will open.
Okay, ma'am. Any other doubts, participants? Okay, then I think we can stop here, ma'am.
Okay.
And now,
yes. In the next session, I will continue from here. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, sure. So now next session will start at 2 p.m. exactly. So there will be a lunch break for 45-50 minutes, and at 2 p.m. we will start the next session. You mail me that project, ma'am. I will mail it to all the participants.
Yeah, I'll do it right now.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Okay. And for participants, thank you, all participants, for your such a good interactive participation. And now we will have lunch break. We will meet at 2 p.m. exactly at 2 p.m. Thank you.